Hello, my name is Professor Matthew Schmidt, and welcome to Genetics. In this session, we are going to focus on the cell division process of meiosis and its relationship with the sexual life cycle. If you've watched the meiosis video, if you've watched the mitosis video, as I suspect you have, we want to start off by highlighting the similarities and differences between mitosis and meiosis. You may recall mitosis, the whole job of it is to make two identical daughter cells from one parent cell. We also said that the whole point of meiosis was in fact to be making cells that would become gametes or sexual cells. So meiosis is intrinsically linked with the sexual life cycle. Now, I don't want to really go into this in a lengthy fashion, but being human, we think of sex in a certain way. And really, a sexual life cycle in a more purely biological sense is a much broader idea. For example, there are animals that do have a completely fine sexual life cycle from a biological point of view, where the male and the female don't even ever see each other, or probably they don't even know who each other are. Many fish would fall into this category. Plants are also sexually reproducing in many cases, and clearly they do not have activities related to the ones that animals do. The flower is the sexual organ of a plant. Pollen from one flower often will fertilize an egg from another flower. So the bottom line, what I'm trying to say, is that the sexual life cycle is a very definite and fundamental biological process. It may be physically accomplished in a variety of ways. We may be interested in that, but we're not interested in it right now. So if we look at the board, we want to see that all, and I mean all, whether it's us, a plant, fungi, whoever is sexual reproducing, and that includes a great amount of the organisms on this world, all sexual life cycles contain two processes, and those two processes are complementary, meaning you sort of can't have one without the other. So meiosis, which we're going to be focusing on today, the whole point of it is we know it's to make gametes, but it's to reduce the chromosome number from 2N to N. And we spoke of that in the last video. So, but it's got to be clarified here why this has to occur. Because if a male makes sperm, for example, and a woman makes eggs, if they were humans and they had 46 chromosomes each, and if they came together, now you'd have 92 chromosomes. And if you follow that logic, every generation the chromosome number would increase. So that would not be feasible. So what we've got to do is we've got to get the chromosome number down in half, and then fertilization is that process that puts it back together again. So meiosis, you can think of as a reductionary process. It gets the chromosome number from 2N down to the haploid value. Fertilization takes an egg and a sperm, or their equivalent, and unites them, but what I mean is puts those things back together so that N plus N here algebraically gets us back to 2N. Then we've got a zygote, which is going to become a new organism one way or another. Now, how does meiosis accomplish this? During meiosis, it turns out that two complete division cycles occur, meiosis I and meiosis II, aptly named, and each division has the same stages as those in mitosis. So there's, in other words, prophase I, metaphase I, anaphase I, telophase I, then there's prophase II, metaphase II, anaphase II, and telophase II. Now, a lot of the things that go on in mitosis, there are similarities with the corresponding phases in meiosis, but there also are some key differences. So we're going to try to highlight the differences in this session, not recapitulate everything that we just discussed about mitosis. So remember, meiosis only occurs in sex cells, cells that are going to give rise to gametes. These are often referred to as the germ or germline cells. In fact, germline is really the opposite of the term we introduced last time, which was somatic. Somatic cells and germline cells together make up all of the cells. The germline are those cells that will make more cells that will create future generations. With that understanding, let's go ahead and really look back on a concept we touched on last time, but now we really want to make sure that we've got it because this is vital for understanding meiosis. Here we have a pair of homologous chromosomes, all right? The blue ones came from the father, their paternal. The red one, well, I should say the one. The red one came from the mother because we're seeing here not only a diagram but a process. Remember, before S phase, you have a homologous pair. You've got a chromosome with one chromatid. That's all it is. And the blue one is similar to that. So what I want to highlight here is that this would be true for mitosis or meiosis, that when they say duplication, we're talking about S phase here. So as S phase occurs, the chromosome gets doubled. And now here we have, just like we saw before, we said it looks like an X. And literally the two chromatids, remember now this is one chromosome composed of two chromatids. They're identical, so they're sister chromatids. The same thing has gone on over here. So these two are also sister chromatids. Now, the relationship of homologous pairs is an interesting one. They're not identical. I mean, the sister chromatids on each one are identical to each other. But the relationship of this to this, as you see here, those are called non-sister chromatids. They're not identical, but they do share something in common. And to illustrate this, go back to the idea of a locus that was introduced a while back. Say that the gene for eye color was on this chromosome. Say this was chromosome number one. What I mean is this. So let's just say eye color. This person has a big B allele at that location. The other allele for eye color would be located the exact same spot on the other chromosome. So in that sense, they have in common the same genetic map, the same loci. And in fact, since these are identical to each other, we should fill in that's the way that it would be. So while the blue and the red homologous chromosomes are not identical, they have in common that they have information about the same traits. Now, I said this was true of mitosis or meiosis, which is correct, but the reason I'm highlighting it here in the meiosis talk is for the following reason. I hope it was sufficiently clear, but if not, let me just say, during mitosis, the homologous chromosomes really took no notice of each other whatsoever. We're about to see that during meiosis, they take great notice of each other. This diagram is just to make absolutely sure that you get the relationship between different types of chromosomes. During the course of this lecture, for technical reasons, the color scheme changes a little bit sometimes, so I'll try and keep you up to date with that so there's no confusion. For example, in this diagram, this is a homologous pair, and they've made them roughly the same color but different shades. This diagram is okay that way because it's just meant to illustrate a different point. And these are two homologous chromosomes. So the two that are directly attached are sister chromatids, right? We said that these two would be non-sister chromatids. This is a homologous pair. This is a different homologous pair, right? So they show them all of the things I'm mentioning are shown somewhere on this diagram. So they're showing that this and this or any of those two from the red and the sort of pinkish looking one would be non-sister chromatids. Also, if you were to compare this large one with that smaller one, those are just non-homologous chromosomes right there. If this is chromosome number one, maybe that one's chromosome number five or whatever, right? So we have just getting the idea that there's one homologous pair, there's another one. They really don't have anything to do with one another, but the terminology stays constant with respect to who's a sister chromatid and who's a non-sister chromatid.